It's been a terrible week for the Victoria Police, which tragically lost four of its members. Senior Constable Lynette Taylor, Senior Constable Kevin King, Constable Glenn Humphreys, and Constable Josh Presney. All of them died doing their job, protecting and looking after us. On behalf of all the Essendon Football Club, its players and staff, fans, members, and the entire Bomber community, we send our condolences to the family and friends and the colleagues of these brave officers. We dedicate this program to all who knew them and loved them and all at Victoria Police.
There's the siren.
Essendon winning their first flag since 1965.
There's the siren. Siren with the game. And Essendon between this for 1985, winning two in a row.
Away goes Michael Long.
Who emerges with the football. Some icing on the cake. Oh, what a finish.
And welcome, Bomber fans. Welcome to the Essendon community for a fourth episode of Working Through It with Adam White to introduce things, and then the big guns coming in with Xavier Campbell, James Hurd, and also Jobe Watson. It is a very, very important episode of Working Through It because John Worsfold, the senior Essendon footy coach, will join us and we'll be taking your calls. So you can give us a call on 1300 652 927. That number again, 1300 652 927. And you can send some text messages through as well, 0416 90 50 52. Or you can send a tweet, and all you got to do is hashtag 4x5pod, and we'll get to as many of those throughout the show. So that's at about 4:30 if you are listening to this live. So I'll tell you a little bit later on when to jump on the phone and give us a call, 1300 652 927. Not just John Worsfold, but also Martin Pakula, who is the State Minister for Sport, Racing and Major Events. He'll join us very shortly. There's plenty to talk to Martin Pakula about. He's a Carlton supporter, which is a bit of an issue, but I'm sure the boys will get plenty of good stuff out of Martin shortly. So let's introduce the guys. And we'll start with the CEO of the Essendon Football Club, Xavier Campbell. Xavier, welcome. As I'm looking at you through Zoom, I can see it's a bit dark where you are. It just shows the nights are coming a bit closer than normal, and it's a pretty gloomy day outside.
That's very true, Whitey. It's got a bit ugly out here at the hangar. It's been a sort of, I think we're changing seasons pretty quickly now, aren't we? We're moving to the next phase of the year.
Yeah, absolutely. James Hurd joins us as well behind his impressive bookshelf, as we see every week. Hurdy, welcome to the program.
Thanks very much, Whitey. And I'm very much looking forward to having Martin Pakula on the show and talking to him all about how the government's handling coronavirus, but more importantly, the question around obviously where he was in 93 when Michael Long kicked that goal. And less importantly, which I'm sure he'll bring up, is where he was in 1999 when Fraser Brown tackled Dean Wallace. But, you know, I think it's going to be fascinating to hear Martin Pakula's perspective on not just sport, but on the whole virus. And also really looking forward to having John on the show and talking about where the club's at from a playing point of view.
Yeah, absolutely. As I said, around about sort of 25 minutes from now, we'll have John on taking your calls. But if you want to send a text message in now, you can. 0416 90 50 52 is probably the easiest way to get that live interaction. You can send them through now, and I'll try and feed them through once John joins Working Through It. But Jobe Watson, he completes the trio. As per normal, Jobe, I'll hand it over to you. Away you go.
Thanks, Whitey, and looking forward to speaking to our guests today. And Xavier, just touching on, you know, those ominous clouds out there at the hangar. I tell you what, it was more ominous when we were doing warm-ups and the smell of the Bay Marie and the sausage rolls and things like that in the old area that we used to be warming up before the hangar was actually built. Hurdy, I know you remember what we used to be doing, back rolls on this carpet that had not been replaced since the 1940s. And it was putting your health and well-being in a little bit of jeopardy doing those warm-ups in that little social area that we had in the cow paddock before everything had been built out there.
Absolutely, Jobe. The sticky floor from the bar the night before and the smell of decaying beer was not a great way for you guys to warm up, but it is what it is. But well said earlier too, Jobe, with the state police. I thought it was very well said, and I'm glad you led the show off that way.
Yeah, obviously it's a very difficult time for everyone in society, but when something tragic like that happens to people who, you know, are serving the community, I think it really hits home to everyone. And, you know, I think that everyone, no matter what club you support or where you are in society, that you certainly feel for the families and friends of those people who are just doing their job and protecting the rest of us. So bit of a somber way to start the show, but looking forward to talking to the people today, and also Herdy, looking forward to finding out what happened with Steph's 21st from last week.
Oh, well, it was a big event, all six of us at the event, and yeah, it was sort of the karaoke that was sung about 10 p.m. I think was very good till the microphone hit my hand, and I was very surprised that there were no police called to that event, because the strangled cat sound that went out around the suburb was quite dramatic. But no, look, I think as good as a day could be, spending your 21st with your parents. Yeah, it was great for Steph to turn 21, but I mean, what could you wish upon a poor girl than spend 21st with the parents? But anyway, that's what it was. But our household's been I think like every other household, it's another week down, another week closer to normality, and it feels like we're getting a little bit closer, and you know, obviously with Martin talking about it. But Xavier, I think the big topic for this week is the return to play in your life. It must sounds like the meetings over the last 3 or 4 days have been very interesting, and a lot of information to impart to our supporters.
Yeah, thanks, Jim. Just before we do that, I'm assuming your go-to was like Mustang Sally or something like that. Was that where you sort of spent your time on Friday night?
Well, I do know that my 16-year-old has got a couple of videos floating around on his phone, so he's been threatened with death if they ever see the light of day. But no, very impressive by the rest of the family.
You were?
No, I can promise you I wasn't. I was about as impressive as... actually, Jobe, you've got some good dance moves, haven't you, on video somewhere? I'm not... Xavier, can we get on to something serious? Otherwise, this could descend into something really, really poor.
No. Back to your initial question. It has felt like it's been a big week this week. Obviously, we're only into Wednesday, but it feels like this is of all the past sort of 4 or 5 weeks in this really strange time. This week has felt like the biggest week so far. It feels like there definitely feels like there's some momentum building. Obviously, if you think about the three different phases that we've sort of been in, that first phase was really around sort of financial stability and shoring up a lot of the back end stuff, like around our, you know, the players' deal was done, the club's deal with the AFL was done. Working really close with our partners to sort of, to reduce our costs and get back to a manageable level, into now the two areas of return to play and the future of the game. And that return to play is sort of, it's definitely picked up. We had a core conference call yesterday with our leadership group, into a call with the entire playing group, into a call with the entire football department, where we started to talk about the pivotal dates that we're going to see over the next little period that will help the AFL shape their announcement for the week beginning the 11th of May. We previously probably thought we were going to get a bit more of an update this week, but clearly the AFL's objective is to be lockstep with government and also the medical advisors, which is absolutely understandable and entirely appropriate. So we've advised our players that we want them to be back in Melbourne on the 11th of May. And then we've also given them some indications around when we sort of think that training may resume and when we think playing may resume. And clearly before all of that, the chief medical officers will meet this Friday. A big agenda item there will be talking about what return to play looks like for the professional coach and also community sport. And then the National Cabinet meeting on Sunday the 10th of May, where we will start to sort of truly understand the views there around what bringing back and clawing back social distancing restrictions looks like and its impact on the AFL return to play.
And Xavier, you were very confident in your opinion the first show that we were coming back to play in July. You know, you put that date out there.
There we go.
Are you still as confident in that date, or are you moving on that?
Well, very confident. Well, I was backed into a corner and I let down my guard. Well, no, it's on the basis that we can continue as a society to, and I think, you know, I think it was a society. I've been so impressed by how disciplined we have been in, generally speaking, in following the social distancing measures. And you can see that in the results that we're achieving so far. And hopefully, if that can continue, and you know, there's that little period left until that week beginning the 11th. If we can continue doing that and continue flattening the curve and the community transmission within society continues to drop, then we put ourselves in a really good position to look at starting football in June, July. Yeah, absolutely. And it's a good question for Martin. Obviously, he would have access to a lot more information than I do. But I do feel pretty confident that all things considered, we're progressing pretty well.
And Xavier, in terms of returning back to footy and what it looks like, I mean, it's really been very topical about the hubs and what that looks like. And we saw, you know, Bucks made commentary today about, you know, not being really practical or the costs of having, you know, 20-week hubs and isolation and things like that. I suppose from your side of things where you've got a much better understanding of the finances, especially of the club, perhaps not as much of the entirety of the AFL. If the players came back and pushed back and said, look, we just can't see this hub system working, what do you think that means for the game? If they say, look, we can't work under these conditions, they're too strict and the consequences are too large, if there's no games being played, what do you think the macro of those consequences are?
Yeah, I mean, I'll stop short of saying it'd be catastrophic, but it'd be truly significant in the sense that, you know, the game as a whole in indefinite stand down, or at least, you know, until social distancing and measures and essentially a vaccine was acquired, like that's essentially it's a pretty significant outcome from a financial perspective. I think if you take it back a step though, like clearly you know, and I've read some of the commentary today and again the whole hubs concept, yeah, we are very much at arm's length, the clubs. I think the AFL is in discussions, and I think it's a really important word, discussions. They're not in disagreement, they're not in negotiation, they are in discussions with the AFLPA around what a hub concept might look like. And a hub concept, and anyone who's been through crisis or issues management will talk to the fact that it is integral to plan for the worst possible outcome, and that would be, you know, social distancing not reduced, a potential second wave coming through, and that's essentially what the AFL has looked to try and create as a platform, an open platform for discussion, a hubs concept that we could potentially use to get our season started. But in reality, you know, where we are in 6 weeks' time when the hubs become, you know, matter of fact and actual is going to be very, very different to where it sits now. This is my personal, I'm probably talking more personally now. Like, where were we 6 weeks ago? We weren't even at round one. We were preparing to play Fremantle. We hadn't stood down staff, we hadn't reshaped our business, and there was so much that we've done from then until now. So it sort of makes you wonder, where will we be in 6 weeks' time? And Martin might be able to provide some insight into that, but I'd imagine if we can continue to be disciplined, continue to do what's required of us by government and download the app to best position us to deal with any potential outbreaks, yeah, I mean, we may be at a point where the hubs, in what we're sort of reading about right now, they'll be a much more diluted format. And that's a potential, that's a probability. That's a potential possibility. So yes, we want our people to feel absolutely comfortable. That is an absolute priority. I don't think at any point of this anyone would say if someone didn't feel comfortable, then they wouldn't be required to go in. But we want to have that perspective that we know that it's going to be, the AFL is going to work really close with the AFLPA to reach a really comfortable solution for all parties.
Xavier, how much of a compromise would you have to make to play games, though? If it came to the situation where there were either games being played and there was finances coming into the game, or there were no games and no finances. Yeah. I mean, eventually you're going to have to make a decision one way or the other.
Yeah, it's, you know, that's, without being too specific, we've done some modelling on that, and it's, you know, it's reshaping how this game looks in a big, big way. You know, I don't want to say something that's going to sound too provocative or that's going to create too many headlines. I know how hurt he said it. Your questioning is very similar to the way James did it in episode one, where you pushed me into the corner. And I feel like I'm going to create some headline out of this, and I definitely don't want to do that. But, I mean, the simple maths is, it's pretty straightforward. Like, we would be reshaping our entire business. What it would mean for our headcount is, I just don't know. What it would mean for the way that we actually, the game progresses into the future. We know it will change now forever, but that would be serious macro step change if that was the case.
Well, Xavier, we're going to save you because I think we have on the line the Victorian State Minister for Sport before Martin Pakula. Martin, are you on the line? Thank you for joining us, if you are.
Oh, I am. I've been listening with interest.
So, Martin, Xavier was meant to throw...
I never thought I'd be on an Essendon podcast, I can tell you.
Well, we worked out before the show, Martin, that Xavier was going to throw the first question to you, but there was one question. There was two questions we wanted to ask you, firstly, before we jump into the seriousness of the situation.
Yeah.
1993 grand final, when Michael Long kicked that goal, where were you as a Carlton supporter?
I was definitely at the ground. I'm trying to remember. I normally can remember where I was sitting. I think I might have been in the Ponsford stand, so I would have been right above it, and that would be right because there's no doubt Silvani touched it. Like, no doubt at all.
Perfect. Perfect. So you were close enough to see that it was touched. That's perfect, that every Carlton supporter at the ground was. And then 99 prelim.
When Harmsy hit the ball back in 79, so I saw that too.
And 99 prelim, where were you when Fraser Brown tackled the poor old Dean Wallace?
I was near enough to sort of what we used to call Bay 13. I was sitting there with a mate of mine, I just remember when the siren went. He injured me. Like, he tackled me that hard out of excitement that he injured me. And it's true, you know. You hear all these Carlton supporters say, "Oh, we didn't really care what happened next week." That's totally true. You know, like, everyone was going, "Oh, well, we win the grand final, we don't. Doesn't matter. We knocked the Bombers out." And had we known that we wouldn't be in another grand final again from then till now, we might have had it. We might have been a little bit more intense about, about the grand final as it was. But we were just so excited about winning the prelim. Probably shouldn't have been.
Now, Martin, we'll get back to talking about the fierce Carlton and Essendon rivalry. But thank you very much for coming on to talk to us, because it's actually it's a perfect time. You're probably about 3 or 4 minutes too late, to be honest, because it's sort of, as Joe was sort of jostling with me to push me in the corner. But I'm keen just to talk to you more broadly from a macro state perspective in terms of how you see the state progressing against managing the COVID-19. I said from the outset on the show, like, I just feel we've been so disciplined, and it's a sense of pride in the way that we've been able to manage it to this point. And clearly we've still got work to do. But, like, how do you see, from where it was 6 weeks ago when we first started to truly understand what this issue was and how big it could get to where we've got to now, like, how would you summarise that?
Oh, it's been an exceptional performance from Victorians. You know, some people out there tend to think that the original threat was overstated. I can tell you that the people who know what they're talking about were seriously concerned about how bad it could get. And it wasn't just because of what's happened in New York or in Italy or in Spain. It's because the modelling tells you that this is a virus that's very, very easily transmissible, much more contagious than the flu, and it has a mortality rate of, you know, around 1% to 2%. And, you know, the massive exponential growth tells you what the possibility was. If it got away, you could have had thousands of people needing hospitalisation very, very quickly. And the capacity of, you know, our system would have been under just as much pressure as a lot of those hospital systems around the world, where you've got more people that need ventilators than can get them. And very, very quickly, you'd have a high mortality rate. So huge concern. And the concern's not gone, because it doesn't take much for it to get away. And we have got winter coming up. But one of the couple of weeks is this rapid scale up of testing, which will give us, I think, a much better picture of what the true numbers are. Now, the first couple of days, we've seen the number of new infections remaining very low. I did a press conference this morning where we announced that there were 3 new positives over the last 24 hours. That's, you know, they are numbers that other parts of the world would you know, would beg and kill for. And the fact is, you know, you have a lot of people who talk about, oh, well, we've got to prioritise the economy. And I said to a group of people last night, and I'll say it to the listeners on this show, that you can't really trade off economic survival and the health outcome. They are two sides of the same coin. I mean, imagine, you know, how do you think the economies of Italy and Spain and the UK and, you know, the USA are doing right now? The fact is that when this is all over and there's an enormously competitive race for business events, for tourists, for international students, for inflows of international capital, one of the things I think that will hold Australia in really good stead will be the fact that we're seen to have been a jurisdiction which managed the health impacts of this really well. And if you turn the economy back on prematurely and the health impacts get out of it, have to turn it off again. And I think as much as people won't like the fact that they're confined to barracks and, you know, not able to go about their normal life right now, I think the thing that they would like even less would be an on-again, off-again situation. You go back for a few weeks and you've got to take, you know, put the foot back down. So, you know, I think a gradual, cautious stage where we reopen a bit, we test, we make sure we're keeping it under control. And if, you know, and if a few weeks in that setting demonstrates that, you know, that we're still on track, then you might be able to do a little bit more and a little bit more. And there'll be some things that don't go back to normal until either you've got a vaccine or you've eradicated it completely from the Australian continent. So, you know, there's a long road ahead of us.
Yeah. So I mean, as a society, we're always quick to jump at government with advice or criticism, but, you know, I think you guys have done an amazing job of managing it to this point, and obviously there's still work to be done. But in 6 weeks' time, obviously, we're probably looking to enter hubs and restart the AFL season. Like, what if we continue at the rate we are now in terms of the test level, the testing level has increased, obviously, the 100,000 over the next fortnight. We continue at the detection rate that we have now, and it continues to drop, perhaps. Like, where could we be in 6 weeks' time as a society when it comes to social distancing, for example?
I think if, you know, and there's two big caveats. If the numbers stay low and if the Chief Health Officer determines this, so let me put those caveats on at the start without having to restate them all the time. I think we might be able to see a gradual relaxation of some of the some of the strictures that are in place right now. You made a really good point before I came on, which was that, you know, 6 weeks ago, you know, we wouldn't have known that we'd be where we are now, and 6 weeks from now it could be very different again. So it's worth remembering that really the thing that caused the AFL season to hit the pause button was the fact that states closed their borders, which made, you know, which made travelling around and playing football with any kind of national fixture impossible. It's equally possible that 6 weeks from now those borders have been reopened. So talk about hubs as if they're almost a fait accompli. They might be the only way that the AFL can start, but it's also possible that if borders reopen, if state and territory governments become more relaxed about people coming and going from their jurisdiction, the options might be even broader than that. So I just think we have to wait and see. Ultimately, you know, the AHPPC, I think, are meeting today. National Cabinet will, at some point in the next few days, I think, have something to consider in terms of some protocols about return to play for both professional sport and community sport. And that might create a framework where, you know, some of these decisions become easier. The way I view it, you know, I think footy will recommence, you know, in the next couple of months or so. I think if it has to be in hubs from a government point of view, we certainly think we can make that work. Whether it works from a AFLPA point of view or a club point of view is obviously not a matter for us. But from a government point of view, we think we can make that work. And if it can be even more liberal than that, well, that, I suspect, would be a bonus. So, you know, I think all possibilities are on the table from, you know, from at one end, the Chief Health Officers are not comfortable with restarting, through to the other end of the spectrum, where it's not out of the question that teams could move around the country and follow something like a normal fixture.
And Martin, I mean, AFL is obviously, you know, very important for our listeners and everyone out there, and everyone wants the game to get started again. As important, I think, for the listeners and people in the community is local sport. I mean, local sport is the sort of the embodiment of the community for a lot of people, for kids, for families, and for even for, you know, for older people who are playing the sport. What has to happen in Victoria before we see any sort of local sport start? Or is it really unrealistic to think that in 2020 we're going to see local sport have any chance of coming back?
No, I don't think it's unrealistic. I think there's a reasonably good prospect of it. And as I said, I think that the work that the AHPPC, and just for the uninitiated, I shouldn't use acronyms, the Australian Health Principles Protection Committee, which is basically the group of chief health officers who get together and meet on a regular basis. So I think the protocols for return to play that they're looking at would include both professional and community sports. So coming out of that, I think there might be a roadmap back to playing. I don't expect that it will be as, you know, laissez-faire as it would have been in the absence of coronavirus, but I think it's likely, not certain, but likely that there'll be a way that some forms of community sport with appropriate social distancing and appropriate modifications might be able to proceed sometime in 2020. I certainly hope so.
And Martin, in terms of people, spectators going to these, not only just community games, but also professional, do you think that is just going to be a bridge too far to get supporters being able to go and watch sporting events in 2020?
Oh, well, look, I think, you know, I think there's probably a big difference between, you know, two or three dozen parents standing around the boundary at the Black Rock Footy Club on the one hand and 80,000 people in the G at the other. So I don't think you can necessarily look at those things through the same lens. I think if the stay-at-home provisions are relaxed and you're allowed to have more, you know, but you're allowed to be out and about more in the community, then it's conceivable that if you had community sport, you know, a few parents could be dotted around the boundary line watching their kids play footy or something if that was going ahead. I think that's probably a bigger chance than having large numbers of people inside a stadium watching AFL. You know, I think just the magnitude of the of a big sporting crowd, the way that people are tightly bunched together in those crowds, and the possibility of transmission in the absence of a vaccine, I think makes that a more difficult proposition.
Do you think the way the AFL has gone about, they've obviously, you know, and I feel like they've been really sound in their decision making this one. They've given themselves a really long runway to execute a season. Reducing it to 17 games quickly was a smart move. We've all felt that. And you contrast that to the NRL, who's looking to start really quickly. I'm not here to compare the two necessarily. But, you know, does that runway potentially give us that opportunity to, if everything does go well, to bring those crowds back? Because obviously we all know how important our membership is. Like, membership is the lifeblood of our football club. And if members didn't have access, it would be heartbreaking in so many respects. But, you know, they support the club for a whole range of reasons. Access to a game is one of those reasons for a lot of those members. Like, you know, you will have seen it in the way you support Carlton. But does that potentially give us a potential upside at the back end when you consider other sports, just that runway that we've been able to create?
Look, everything's possible. And the problem with talking about the track of this virus with any certainty is, you know, trying to project anything 4, 5, 6 months ahead is pretty difficult. I mean, it's possible but unlikely that in a few months' time there'll be a vaccine. I think it's actually really unlikely that there'd be a usable vaccine in that period of time. But I'm not an epidemiologist. I suppose it's possible. It's also possible that at some point there's a degree of confidence that the virus has been completely eradicated from the Australian continent. Again, you'd need to see literally zero new cases around the country for probably 4 months before anyone had the confidence that that had happened. But it's not impossible. So I suppose in those circumstances, the more runway you give yourself, the more possibility you create that things might be in your future. The other point, I think it's unlikely, but it's not impossible in short, Xavier. I think the other thing that's worth saying is the AFL, from my perspective, have handled themselves impeccably. They've been incredibly respectful of the chief medical officer, not just here in Victoria, but the dialogue they've had around the country with other states and with the Commonwealth. They've been very, very keenly aware, not just of what they might be technically allowed to do, but in how the things that they do are perceived by the community. And I think the AFL and AFL clubs and AFL fans should be very pleased about the way that they've been led in this period of time.
Martin, there's a number of debates going on in households about, you know, whether schools should be reopened, whether they shouldn't be reopened, and I know that's outside your jurisdiction, but one of the big debates in households is should they download the COVID Safe app? And it's a federal government decision, but from a state government position, is this something that you guys fully support? And the worries about, you know, cyber security and safety, it's going on in our household, you know, it's two divisions, as you should download or not. What's the state government's view on the COVID Safe app and should people download it or not?
Well, we support it because it gives us the best chance of getting back to something approaching normal. Downloaded it. I think just download. I'm satisfied that the personal privacy data security processes sufficient. I can understand why people would be dubious about providing more information to anyone. But the fact is that there's a lot of personal information out there already. That a lot of people answer quizzes on Facebook, which probably provide more personal information about themselves than this app ever will. And it is really the key to being able to get back to something approaching normality, to reopening business, and to having a good chance of being able to contain any outbreaks in the future. On balance, we support it, and I think people should put their reservations about it aside. It's my own personal view. But as Greg Hunt says constantly, it's voluntary. No one has to download it. I've chosen to do so.
And Martin, just finally from me, in terms of Victoria, if there was a hub situation, you're confident that the state would have one if it turned out that that was the best case moving forward?
Well, as I said, subject to the views of the Chief Health Officer, if there was going to be a hub situation, I'd certainly be supportive of Victoria being the location of one of them. I'm confident that we could provide a good, secure hub and the best possible facilities for players and staff. So I'd be very hopeful that we would be the location of one of those hubs if that's the way the AFL chooses to go. But, so long as our medical supremos say it's safe and that we're not risking the spread of the disease, then I would be certainly hopeful and confident that we would be a host for one of those hubs.
Martin, thank you very much for coming on our podcast today. Normally, in our pre-production meeting yesterday, Jobe and James, they were going to go the jugular based on your Carlton allegiance, and they've pulled back markedly from where we sort of thought.
I thought you were going to ask me about how the rivalry began in my household.
Well, one, it would be good to get your closing remark, because we've got Woosher on the phone. He's our next special guest. But, like, the Carlton-Essendon rivalry was a special one. How would you describe it?
I'll tell you two quick stories that describe it for me. So I actually come from a mixed Carlton-Essendon family. Dad's side was Carlton. my mum's brother, so my uncle and all the cousins on that side are all Bombers, and so it's always been pretty fierce. I went with my Essendon supporting uncle to that game in 1981 when I think he came from 26 points down and Neil Danaher got hold of Bruce Stuhl and the free kick paid against him. And that traumatised me as a 12-year-old. My uncle rubbing that in my face, I think, traumatised me for a long time, and probably was the genesis of the inter-family rivalry. And just to put it in a more modern context, we were at the game in, I think, 2013, the one where after the Melksham game, where Wake kicked seven and we'd been well in front in the last quarter, and you came over the top. The second game that year, we were again, I think, three or four goals up at three-quarter time, and the Essendon comeback started. And I said to my son, "Let's go." At the point we left, we were still two goals up. And Ben said, "Why are we going?" I said, "Ben, I know how this finishes." We were in the car driving home when Zaharakis kicked the goal. The game had been tied, and you guys won by a goal with 30 seconds to go. And my son, who was, I think, about 11 at the time, looked at me and said, "How did you know that was going to happen?" I said, "I just knew, Ben. I've been to too many of these games. I just knew." And I said, I didn't want to be there when it happened.
Well, Martin, thank you very much for coming on. We really appreciate it. You guys have done a really great job thus far managing through this. The government has done an enormous work for our game of AFL football, and we're very, very thankful for that. So thanks very much for coming on, and good luck over the next few weeks.
Thanks for having me on, and good luck with the season, guys.
Thanks, Martin.
Okay, so Martin Pakula there, the Victorian Minister for Sport, joining us on Working Through It on this Wednesday afternoon. Now, I know the next guest is one that everyone is looking forward to chatting to, and we can do that by giving us a call on 1300 652 927 shortly. I speak of the coach of the Essendon Football Club, John Worsfold. He'll join us next, but before we get there, just a reminder that there are plenty of sentimental favourites to new content offerings, and that is what Don's Digital is all about on essendonfc.com.au, keeping you engaged, enlightened and entertained during the break. All you got to do is go to the website essendonfc.com.au, which is exactly what you're doing at the moment. One of the most popular things on the website is Adrian Dodoro's Dodcast, and the latest one is involving Andrew McGrath, Essendon's first ever number one pick, and here's a little bit of that podcast.
Just before we went live to air, I sent a text to Setterfield, McCluggage and Andy McGrath, and I just said, "Boys, good luck. Don't know how this is going to go, but you'll find out in about 10 minutes. So they had no idea who we were picking, and I think it was good for them, for everyone, and for the integrity of the draft as well. But yeah, and then we called Andy out, and it was a complete and utter surprise to him and to Mike and Sandy, his parents, because they had no idea. I think it's something that we did really well, and I think it added to a very, very special moment for his life and his career.
Andrew McGrath now is one of Essendon's star players, and I know all Essendon fans love watching him play every weekend. Now it is time. We're going to go to James Hurd here to introduce our feature guest. We'll take some calls shortly, 1300 652 927. Text message 0416 90 50 52. There's already literally scores of them that have come through from Essendon fans this afternoon. But James, over to you.
Thanks, Whitey. And John Worsfold, how are you? Do we find you in the backyard touching up on your TikTok performance or just in the lounge room?
Are you saying that it needs touching up, James?
Do you want me to go into it?
No, I've had plenty of feedback. Put it this way, no, I'm not touching it up, and it won't be brought out again. But it was good fun doing it with my daughter, and it's obviously, just different time. So I thought I was happy to buy into building up a little bit of, promotional activity around the Anzac Day game that wasn't going to happen. So hopefully it did go some way to showing that we were still committing and contributing to the memory of our Anzacs in some way.
If you need some help with dance moves, we'll show you. Can always happy to provide some choreography. You know that I'm very skilled.
Yes, Joe, your dance moves did get the occasional one in team meetings, didn't they?
Just occasionally.
They still carried on there. Well, that's impressive, Joe. John, thank you for giving us your time. I've got the question from my perspective is your time at Essendon. You know, you've come to the club in terrible times. Really, the club at the end of 2015 was at lowest ebb. And what I'd like to dig into is what you think your proudest moment has been there. Because from my perspective, you took over the club, as I said, the lowest ebb. You've taken the club through 2016 when you lost 10 of the 12 of your best players, winning finals, or getting to the finals, taking it and rebranding a club along with the administration of a club. How have you found that? And if you were to take us through the proudest moment or what you thought has been your greatest success, because from the outside, I think that it's been a little bit underestimated what a job you've done to get the club to where it is now, sort of 4 or 5 years after you took over the coaching role.
Yeah, look, it's obviously what I'm proud of is being part of the club, not necessarily rebranding itself, but working back from where it was, working through the challenges of supporting not only the, for me more so, the 12 currently listed players that were suspended, but from the club's perspective, supporting the 34 players that were impacted, but through that period. But while doing that, focusing on the job at hand, which was preparing a team to actually take the field and play. So, yeah, if you can imagine that in January and February of 2016, we were looking for top-up players to come onto our list and help us get a team on the park. And there were pretty strict guidelines around which, who we could add onto our list. Generally, they had to be retired players or players that had been delisted from clubs. So pretty much players that were no longer deemed, valuable enough to stay on other clubs' lists. We were seeking those guys, and we obviously looked for one guy that was sound enough to be able to get through games of footy, but that would contribute through their character as well. And I think we did a pretty good job with that. So working through a year where we only won the 3 games in 2016, but we made big inroads into, building the squad that we still had there. Some of the young players that got opportunities, players like Anthony McDonald, Dippin Woody, and certainly Horatio Fantasia, who got more regular games and have become really top-line players for the Essendon Football Club. So I think that year, just being able to stay positive and make it a real positive and enjoyable environment for the guys that were there to grow their own football and for the club to put the building blocks in place to rebound. And so I've seen the club, really up until this current crisis that we've all hit, the club were really back in really strong shape financially and with a strong vision of the new premises that have been being put together, and the playing list was coming together really well. So I'm really proud that when I finish at the Essendon Football Club, I'll certainly feel like it's in really good shape going forward to be successful.
And do you think that's been underestimated? I mean, you're a super competitive person. Obviously won premierships as a player at West Coast, coached West Coast to a premiership. Do you think that's been underestimated in your legacy, what a job you're able to do to not only get the club through that year, but then, I suppose, rebound it into a finals year a couple of years later?
Yeah, look, I certainly believe to have brought the players back in off a year out of footy and bring them back into the fold and have us going well enough to make the top eight was a remarkable effort from everyone involved. Now, we bowed out in the finals, but just to finish in that top eight, I thought, was pretty special. But we all get measured ultimately on winning finals and we all aim to win premierships. So that's certainly what my aim was, to come to Essendon and get the club in a position to win a premiership as quickly as possible. And you know, when the suspensions, when I started Essendon, I wasn't planning on the suspensions coming to fruition. So that obviously changed all the expectations of the next few years. And, you know, I'll be as proud as anyone if I can see Essendon really start to produce on the field and get right up in that top four and challenge for a flag in the next few years with everything we've put together. But in terms of has it been undervalued, I think internally with the club, you know, as I said, I'm really proud of the small part that I've played as part of a team that worked hard for the footy club to get it back going. And, you know, Xavier leads that. And, you know, I think everyone's just done a remarkable job in getting the club back to where it is now and in a position to survive this crisis, because if we didn't get it right back in 2016, then there's every chance this crisis could have been, you know, really drastic outcome for the footy club. So to have been in a position, and a strong and sound enough position to be able to say to the AFL right now that we're going to try and stand alone and not go in and become an assisted club is quite remarkable.
Well, she, you talk about, you know, the small part that you play, but you were the head of, you know, like the head coach, you know, in a really, really tumultuous time. I remember, you know, we'd only sort of just started our the relationship as a player and coach, but it got flipped on its head, you know, really dramatically, and you're able to hold the club and together, but also for it to prosper. I mean, your experience as a coach now, where you've dealt with, you know, things that took place in West Coast that were obviously, you know, difficult and challenging. You came through into Adelaide at a really difficult time to lend a hand and to be there and involved. And now for the second time at Essendon, I mean, it's been a lot of interruptions in terms of your coaching career. I'm just wondering, like, the experiences that you've had along the way, how are you then being able to impart that on the guys who are currently faced with such uncertainty in the current moment, and not only just not players, but also staff and support staff and their families?
Yeah, well, this is certainly a different sort of crisis than any of the others that I've been involved in, and this has been just so widespread, it's impacted everyone. Some of the other crises that I've been involved in have been a little bit more directed, where we can work with a tighter group and get through it. But ultimately, it's the same. It's just the communication around why the current situation is like it is, and then where do we want to be in 12 months or in 2 years or 3 years' time, and what are we going to start to put in place to get to that position? So, you know, I've always been heavily... all my coaching's been around looking in the future and planning to get to a place, and that's been no different with this current situation. It's we've got certain parameters we have to deal with. Obviously, the financial constraints that are going to hit the football club are going to be pretty massive, but we have to just work and make the best possible decisions about where we want the club to be within these constraints that we're going to face. So really, it's just communicating that, making the decisions that you have to make that you can't shy away from, and clearly communicating those decisions and focusing on the new systems that you need in place to keep growing and going forward. Now, in this situation, every club's facing the same challenges. So, you know, I feel as though we're really well situated to come out of it strongly. One... you know, Xavier's strong experience in working through these situations, as well as my own. I think as much as any club, we've got people at the footy club who probably already had an idea about how we wanted to work our way through this.
John, now a more football question. Obviously a fantastic win against Freo in round one. Probably 6 weeks till we, hopefully 6 weeks till the boys start playing football again. What's going to change this year compared to last? You could see a little bit of what the guys are working on in round one, but you're confident with those changes you're able to make in the pre-season that you'll go a lot deeper into September than perhaps you did last year?
Well, that's that's certainly what we're working towards. There was a couple of unknowns going into the start of the season. Obviously, one, we had a few of our key players unavailable, with obviously Dyson and Carl Hooker and Hep out, James Stewart. So we went in a little bit undermanned. This break in the season has given us the opportunity to say that hopefully those guys are going to get back and contribute in more games than they would have otherwise. So that's potentially going to play into our hands and advantage us a little bit than it would have otherwise. But the downside is that we'd built a fair bit of momentum through the pre-season with a pretty carefully constructed program of implementing the new language and the new game style that that Blake and Ben were driving. And we've lost a lot of that momentum. So, clubs that have been playing a certain game plan for 2, 3, 4 years, they'll come back and not miss a beat, straight back into it. We'll potentially have to re-educate the players to get them back to the same level they were at when the season went into shutdown. So there's some challenges there, but they're obviously not insurmountable, but it will have some impact. Always almost impossible to measure how much of an impact that will have, but overall, I think if we can keep our squad fit and healthy and available, potentially the type of season we're going to face may assist us as much as any other club in that the games will be a little bit shorter. So with our speed, which is one of our key strengths, we should be able to really take it up the teams and not be too worried about drop-offs late in games. And try and use that to our advantage. So as we find out some of the whether there's extra players on the bench, again, we feel as though that may play more into our advantage with our list makeup than it would some other clubs. So there's some pros and cons with the season to come, but suffice to say we're doing everything we can to find all the avenues that are going to make sure we're performing at our absolute best.
Okay, this is an opportunity now for Essendon fans, Bomber members, to get on the line and chat to John Worsfold. 1-300-652-927 is the number. And kindly, Essendon, through Coles, are giving away vouchers up to $150 each if the callers are good enough. So 1-300-652-927, there's a bit of a carrot for you if you want to have a chat to John Worsfold. You can also send a text message through on 0416 90 50 52. There have been a lot of those, and I'll try and feed a few of those in as we keep John on the line. But John, before we go to calls, just a question to you, I guess on behalf of the Essendon fans and members, what has the Essendon membership meant to you, particularly through these challenging times? You looked after a very big club in West Coast Essendon, also a big club. What sort of stands out for you?
Yeah, look, one of the first things that stood out to me was the loyalty of the members. People introducing themselves to me, whether it was at a club event or just at training, or even just on the streets of Moonee Ponds or Essendon. People would introduce themselves, and they were so proud to, when they introduced themselves, they had to add on how long they'd been a member. So it was like ingrained in their personality. So they would introduce themselves and say, I've been a member for, and up to 72 years, I think, is the record of it. I've had someone coming and letting me know that. So whether it's 30 years, 40 years, 60 year members, the club that, when I left West Coast, they were, maybe 26 years old, the club in its history. So to have members that have been that loyal and supportive of the footy club, generational members, which West Coast are just starting to probably get now, that was just inspiring. Really, it really showed me that we've got to do a good job for these people. It's so much part of their life. It means so much to them, and that they are part of. They are a real part of the Essendon Football Club. They've been involved in the club longer than any current player, any current employee at the footy club. These people have been members and supporters of the club. So that loyalty really stood out. And, even their passion to say that they had been derided by opposition supporters for a while, but they copped that on the chin and, didn't back down to saying we're never going to be embarrassed to... support the Essendon Footy Club. We're going to stick with it. We're going to come out of this strong, and you know, they've shown that with the club getting a record membership last season.
Well, talking about passionate fans, to start the calls off on 1300 652 927, these questions are meant to be for John Worsfold, but this one is actually for Xavier Campbell. Xavier, this caller is Rosanna, and she is calling us live from New York, where it's about 3 o'clock in the morning. Rosanna, welcome to Working Through It.
Hi, guys. Thanks for doing this.
No problems at all. What's your question?
So Xavier, I was just wondering, last month there were talks about Essendon potentially playing GWS in the US in future. So given the current circumstances, are you still considering that opportunity? Like, just so I have some hope.
Well, thanks for calling in. Thanks for getting up so early. This is that's Jobe's second favourite city in the world. He spent so much time over there. But We definitely are. Like, clearly we need to revisit our strategy and model and how we're going to sort of look at executing that moving forward. One area that we're heavily dependent on with respect to the potential to play in the US is working with the International Cricket Council and the establishment of appropriate venues in the US. Like, that is a part where there is a couple under construction right now in California. Now, we haven't got an official update. We've got a call tomorrow, Friday morning. What's that? Not tomorrow morning, next morning, to discuss where that's at, where we'll be talking one of the key people from there. So hopefully it hasn't been too delayed because of this. We definitely still feel passionately about the principles which we made that decision. It's a big market, sports-loving market. There's a lot of synergies, a lot of opportunity, and GWS is still keen. So that's very much still on the radar, but we still need to work through it in more detail over the next sort of 6 months, I'd imagine.
Fantastic, Rosanna. Thank you very much for your call. So you get up in the middle of the night and watch the Bombers play?
I do. So I have my international membership. So I have Watch AFL. I had to stay up for this because, like, how often do you get to talk to the CEO and, like, legends of your club? I did have a question for Jobe, though, if that was okay.
Go for it.
Yeah, just you've had quite the career, so I was just wondering personally, like, what time in your career did you enjoy the most, like a year or a period?
I enjoyed my year off in 2016, in retrospect.
I knew.
But the thing that I miss most now is the time that I spent, you know, with the teammates and in the locker rooms. And I remember, you know, like, I felt like we were really building a really strong group that was potential to challenge, it deep into finals and had the, the framework of a really strong side, you know, in that from 2011 onwards, really. I felt like we were building a squad. So that was probably my most enjoyable time was, that 2011, 12, 13, that period was, when I look back at it, I thought that was the best team that I'd played with, and I was older and I could appreciate a bit more. And when you're young, you just sort of, you're there and you're happy and you're enjoying playing, and the longer you get, the more you realize how difficult it is to get there. And I suppose that was, when I look back, I think, oh, that was the time I probably enjoyed the most.
Fantastic, Rosanna. Thanks very much for joining us all the way from New York. So from New York, we now go to Craigieburn, and Zook's given us a call and wants to chat to John Worsfold and the team. Zook, good afternoon to you.
G'day, guys. How are you? Loving the podcast. It's awesome. Yeah, hi to everybody. Wilsh, just one question, mate, I really, really want to know. And if everything goes well, do you think we can win the flag this year, or do you think we're maybe still 1 year away?
Yeah, well, I always think we can win the flag, yeah. Who knows what happens with other clubs, availability of players, how this season's going to play out, how everyone's going to adapt to being in hubs, playing off short breaks. It's given every club the opportunity. There's obviously a few clubs that, when you look at their list, their makeup and the age and experience demographic, and obviously past form over the last few years, they deserve to be favourites to be in the grand final or in the top four of the ladder. And Essendon aren't really listed in that group as such yet. So we've got a bit of work to do to prove that we're worthy of being seen as a top four team. And that's when you're really in the hunt to win a flag. So our aim is to try and certainly show that we're closing that gap and closing in on that top four crew. And if you can do that and finish, you know, especially in the top six in a season like this season is going to be, I think it's going to be everyone's in it in the finals. Everyone's going to be a chance to win it. So that's our aim. But in saying that, I think our squad is going to grow and get better over the next couple of years as some of our star young players move into their, you know, peak years. We've got quite a few players that are, you know, a year or two off being at their best, and providing some of our really experienced gun players like Hurls and Hooksey and, well, Zarakis and these guys maintain their form, that means we're going to be a better team. As McGrath and Parrish and Redmond and these guys naturally improve their game, they are talented enough to become real stars of the game. They're going to move into those years starting from now. So, yeah, I think it'd be nice to think we're going to be right in the mix this year and definitely next year and the year after going forward, I think the club's going to keep growing.
Well done, Zook. Good question. Hang on the line and we might get a Coles voucher out to you. That was a good question. John, there's plenty of text messages coming through. One, which is a bit of an obvious one, but I think it's good to get an update at the same time, just around Joe Danaher and the gap in the season that we've got at the moment. What an advantage is that going to be for not only Joe, but for Essendon? And also, what role do you think he'll play when he does come back?
Yeah, well, obviously, first of all, our aim is to get Joe in a position where he's over this injury completely. It doesn't flare up again and his footy career recommences and he can reach the potential that we know he's got. He's certainly shown glimpses of being a star player. So that's really our aim. And I would expect that when he's in that position, he'll play mainly as a key forward. He may go on ball occasionally as around the ground ruckman where he does impact games. He's clever enough to find the ball and get it going forward for us. But generally, he'll be one of those tall targets forward for us. And, you know, the way that we're setting up to play the game now, I think it'll suit Joe more than ever. So when we get him back out on the park and, you know, get the rustiness out, it's going to be hard to see how he... basically, his only footy he may play this year will be at AFL level. He may not get the opportunity to play at a lower level just to get his touch right. So it may take a month of actual playing footy for Joe to start to get his rhythm going. But the key thing is get him strong enough to make sure that this injury isn't ever going to flare up again. And he can, as I said, continue on his career, which is going to be a wonderful career. And our aim is that it's going to be a wonderful career for the Essendon Footy Club.
1300 652 927 if you want to chat to John Worsfold or any of the guys on the podcast this afternoon. Text message 0416 90 50 52. And I've got to say, there is so many to get through. I'm going to try and get to as many as I can and kind of paraphrase them a little bit and collect some together. One here is just a question about, you kind of answered this, but the improvement required. You talked about the depth maybe from some of the younger players coming through to get to the next level, but just maybe a couple of other things that you might need to improve to get into that top four.
Yeah, well, the areas that we want to improve on is our efficiency as we go inside our forward 50. There's not a big difference between most teams in terms of the number of entries inside your forward 50. The teams that can be really efficient and make the most of those inside 50 entries to get a score on the board as opposed to giving the opposition the chance to rebound from there and score at the other end. So that's something we've been working pretty hard on. And, you know, having Devin Smith back out on the park and getting Horacio Fantasia back to his best form, those things are certainly going to help. And if Joey gets back out there, that's going to help us as well in that regard. So there's that. There's... obviously, when I touched on the younger players just growing into becoming the great players that we're hoping they're all going to become, is just the chemistry of playing together. You know, the best teams I played in were really when I was playing alongside guys, I just knew which way they were going to turn. I knew how they were going to react in any given contest they were going into, whether, you know, a one-on-one contest, I knew some teammates would try and mark the ball, other teammates would just spoil it towards the boundary line, and you would adjust your position according to how well you knew your teammates. So, you know, we're a fairly young group in terms of the number of games that we've played together. So when we see Stringer and Danaher together in the forward line for 20-odd games in a row with Fantasia and Donald Tupuwulu and Devin Smith up there, we're going to start to see how well it can really function. So that's the next part of it, is to not only build individual players up to becoming the best player they can be, but build the chemistry so that you know, Mason Redmond and Adam Saad and Michael Hurley know each other, you know, inside out, in the way that they're going to support each other in the back half. And those things do make a big difference. So that's something that we're working on. And I also touched on the fact that it's a relatively, some parts of our game plan are fairly new and different for the players, and they've worked their backsides off to learn it quickly over one summer. And I think they've done a wonderful job both learning it, but also in the way it's been coached by the coaches. And they're only going to get better at playing this style of footy as they really start to understand it and become just more natural and second nature for them, as opposed to thinking, you know, how are we meant to be moving the ball in this situation? So that's where that only takes time. You can't rush that, and you've got to be patient with that. But that's why I believe Essendon will be a better club, a better footy team next year, and possibly the year after as well.
John, one of the issues that has come up, and Nathan Buckley, I think, broached it this morning on radio, was around if, you know, potentially players, the mental effect it's going to have on players if clubs do go into hubs. What would your view be if, you know, five players with young families come to you and said, look, John, we just can't go. I mean, we've got to support our wives, our kids. It's just something that we don't feel comfortable with. How do you handle that? One, maybe two, maybe okay. But if you've got a group of five or six, how would you handle that from the coaching and club point of view?
Well, this is one of the things that may play into our favour, is that we've only got one player with children, young children. So all the others are going to be making up stories. They're going to miss their dog or miss their partner. So, we've got a squad that isn't reproducing very much at the moment. So, look, we would deal with that by, one, communicating this is how it's going to look, this is how we think it's going to work, but understand this has never been done and there's going to be challenges as we go. So, you know, what I've seen in the past, I've recruited kids from interstate that have been gung-ho about, all I want to do is get out of my hometown, relocate, it's going to be so good for my footy. This is the thing I need. I need to get away from my mates and focus on my footy 100%. They're the guys that are 4 weeks later are more homesick than anyone else. And the guys that you look and say, geez, they're coming from a tight-knit family here, they're going to really struggle to break away, have adapted to being away from family way better. So you can't really pick how it's going to feel 1 week in, 2 weeks in, or a month in, but we need to have the avenues open to be able to communicate and talk, and players to feel comfortable to, you know, not feel like they're letting anyone down or being weak if they go and talk to someone about struggling due to homesickness, missing their family, whatever it may be. We'll address all those things as we go, but we are certainly aware that it will hit us. We won't be able to really predict who will feel that way or when they'll feel that way, but there will be times when that will arise, and we'll just talk through it. And sometimes we may be able to just shift things a little bit where they're still comfortable to stay and play, and there'll be other times when they say, I don't think I'm going to mentally be on top of my game unless I get home for a short period and reconnect with my family. So, yeah, it's such an unknown, but we will support the players 100%. One of the areas, we've got young coaches who do have young families, and we'll be conscious of how that looks for them as well. So there will be some challenges in whatever the situation looks like, and we'll just prepare and support everyone in working through those.
And Wilsha, just a final one from me. Just who were you sort of most excited to see run out and play? Like, you get to watch players, you know, particularly progress through pre-seasons. You know, you guys, they arrive in October, and by the time February rides around, you think, God, this person's completely different to the one that I thought arrived. Was there someone, is there someone that you think, oh, I was really really looking forward to seeing how much they were going to elevate their game.
Well, yeah, there was two guys which have been fairly well publicised, and then they weren't first or second year players, but Andy McGrath and Darcy Parrish, who you know are going to be very, very good midfielders for the Essendon Footy Club, and they haven't spent a lot of time in the actual midfield up to this point in their career. But I was really excited about the opportunities that they were going to get, spending more time going through playing on ball and supporting those more mature midfielders through there. But, you know, really, they've got the opportunity to step up and become A-grade midfielders. And you know, they both had wonderful pre-seasons, had done a mountain of work and looked like, you know, they were going to be in some very solid seasons for us. So that's still what I'm really keen to see as we hit the ground running again in hopefully in a 6 or 8 weeks' time. Really keen to see those guys back in action.
Okay, guys, Chris from East Keilor has given us a call, and it's a good question, this one from Chris. Chris, fire away.
Yeah, hi guys. This question's for Woosha. I just wanted to know, a lot's been said about the challenges players will face in the hub-type scenario. Personally, what do you think will be your biggest challenges you face as a coach, and also coaching the team, what are the challenges you think will be in place for you?
Yeah, look, a few of the challenges we've spoken about. One, we don't know what our coaching structure will look like in the hub, how many coaches we're allowed to have there. So, one, how we actually coach the group. How we divvy up the work between who's available, how we review games if they're games off, if you're playing a game every 5 days, how do you learn from that? Because we are still in that position where we're learning about how well the guys are adapting to a new game plan. Other clubs, you know, Richmond wouldn't have to review too much because they've been playing that way for a number of years. So we'll have to work out exactly what balance we have from just preparing, recovering from a game and then the quick preparation ready to play the next opposition versus educating the players about some of the things we're still working on and learning. And so they're the key things. But which players can back up off 5 days if you have 3 or 4 games in a 15 to 20-day period, how well do you manage your players? Which players can play long minutes in those games? Which players might need a week off somewhere? Have we got the players to replace them and not lose momentum? So these things are going to be, I think, serious considerations when we get back going, where after 3 games, rapid fire in succession, do you rest 8 or 9 players and bring fresh guys in for the next week or two before you reload again? And do you manage that against different opposition, try and read what they're going to do? So we don't know what the fixture is yet. We don't know where we're going to be based and what the grounds look like, but there's some of the challenges that that we'll face as a coaching group going forward. And my understanding is there won't be a lot of flexibility in a training program if you're in a hub situation with a lot of other clubs and potentially sharing gym facilities. You'll be allocated time where your club's got the gym or your club's got the training ground. So we'll have to be very flexible in how we want to progress and prepare the team to play, understanding some of the limitations that will be on us.
John, unfortunately we've run out of time. We could listen to you talk all day about what's going to come and how the hub structure is going to play. But firstly, thank you for your time. Good luck over the next 4 to 5 months. I think every Essendon supporter is intrigued by what's about to happen, but wishes you all the luck. And from me personally, congratulations on the job you have done over the past 5 years. I think you've handled yourself magnificently and put our club back in a position where we can be more than competitive again, and something to be very proud of. So well done, and thanks for coming on the show.
My pleasure. Thanks, guys. Thanks for your help through this period as well. Sounds like it's going brilliant. So all in it together, and we'll come out of it strong, eh?
Terrific.
Thanks, Woosh.
Fantastic. John Worsfold, the coach of the Essendon Football Club, joining us. We tried to get to as many texts as we could. A lot of those texts came, you were sort of answering those as you went along, so we're trying to get as much interaction as possible. Make sure you hang on the line, Chris, because I think your question absolutely deserves a Coles voucher. We'll sort of reflect a little bit more on what John said shortly with the guys, but now is the moment for the Coles Mighty Moment for the week, and we go back to 2001 and arguably the greatest mark of all time.
Lalich doing well to Heffernan. Second time he's taken out in a minute. Lucas read it best. Wrong side for him. Hooks a ball. What a mark! Sensational!
He's taken the wind out of himself. And why wouldn't he? Because he sucked it in from the stratosphere when he was up there.
When that ball was kicked, I thought he's got no chance of marking it. And he's that hot. He just threw himself at it and it stuck. Joe Mussini just looked at the scoreboard and said, I want to see it again.
I tell you what, I look at Chris Tarrant's looking at the scoreboard and saying, I might have lost the car.
That is it. That is it.
What? Unbelievable, Mark.
That is going to be on bars and that's going to be in the on pub walls for the next 100 years, that side on shot.
I tell you how good it is. It'll be on CNN. Unbelievable.
And that certainly was a Coles Mighty Moment. Two extraordinary moments, really. Scott Lucas kicking on his right foot and then the mark from Gary Moorcroft. Herdy, what can you remember of that mark from Gary Moorcroft?
Yeah, it was against the Western Bulldogs, I'm pretty sure. Oh, look, an amazing mark by Gary, but it wasn't surprising because Gaz had an incredible leap, and Mark Harvey, his assistant coach, used to take the marking bag out there at the end of training, and your likely suspects, you know, Lloydie, McCurry, Lucas, these guys would go and take some pretty amazing marks on Harves' back, but Gary used to take some sensational grabs. And he was a very, very cheeky man out in the ground. But, you know, look, one of the best marks I've ever seen by a mile. But it also hurt his career a bit from memory. I think when he landed, he hurt his back or his hip and really didn't... That sort of troubled him for the rest of his career from memory. But, you know, premiership player at the Bombers in 2000... Fantastic bloke, and yeah, he deserved to have Mark of the Year or potentially Mark of the Century with that mark.
Yeah, it was quite amazing, wasn't it, Jobe? Have you seen a better mark over your time playing or watching?
No, I don't think so. I think for in terms of like the elevation and how quickly he got up, and you know, that iconic shot, that side shot of his body sort of contorted the direction that it was. And I can echo Herdy's sentiments about Gary being cheeky on the field. I remember in my second year playing in the reserves, you certainly knew where he was, and he gave you some strong feedback if he felt like you didn't give the ball in a position where he could take it off you. And so it was always a good experience. And he went on to have a very successful career post footy in local leagues as well. And I think he ended up playing some games with his son actually in the same team. I remember seeing it. So, he's a fantastic Essendon player.
Yeah, absolutely. Another thing that is a big part of the Essendon website is on the couch, and we're seeing plenty of reflections of the 2000 Premiership particularly, and we've got to play a little bit of Dustin Fletcher and his thoughts on the 2000 AFL Grand Final win.
My main memory, I think, was probably Dean Wallace, who I was obviously playing next to in the back line, and we had a pretty strong back line in, you know, Dean Solomon and Mark Johnson, so... But I remember Dean Wallace saying to me all through the week, and he said on game day, he said to me, if things get a bit hot in the kitchen, you won't have to worry about me. And I didn't really know what he was talking about. And I said, oh, what do you mean by that? And he said, you know, if push comes to shove, you know, I'll be the first one in there. And I remember, I think it was early in the game, Wally and Schwartz are having a bit of a go at it in the goal square, and I think by somehow Wally actually sort of poked him in the eye. And I remember Wally sort of, I was about to take the kick in, and Wally just looked at me and sort of, he gave me a wink and said, things are going to be right. So from that time onwards, you know, playing with guys like, you know, Solly, you know, Dean Wallace and Mark Johnson, Damien Hardwick in that back line, I thought we were a pretty strong unit. And, you know, things got a bit out of hand at times. I think Brad Green might have caught one, and, you know, Wally was always in there. So that was my moment, only a small little moment, I suppose, but one that gave me the confidence to play out. And, if something was going to go down, he was going to be there for me.
So that is Dustin Fletcher. It's interesting, Herdy, just listening to that and comments that Kevin Sheedy made to us about having those tough players, those enforcers, and being a bit mean and nasty when required. Essendon's had a few of those over the time, and they've been really positive influences on the footy club. What was it like for you when you had those guys sort of helping support you when Essendon was at its strongest?
Oh, the great thing about that team of that era was that it was a very skillful team, it was a very hard-working team, and you know, obviously had some very talented players, but it was an extremely tough and hard team. And Fletcher's gone through it, but with Dean Wallace, Dean Solomon, Mark Johnson, Jason Johnson, Fletch himself, Sean Wellman, you just felt safe out on the ground. You know, even Gary Moorcroft, who could handle himself pretty well when he needed to, safe out on the ground at any stages. And yeah, extremely talented team, but as tough as it was talented. And Dean Wallace probably stood head and shoulders above them all in that respect. And certainly, you know, when you'd run past a pack and Wally'd wink at you, your man seemed to end up on the ground or on his backside. And he was a fantastic teammate to have, and certainly helped us win that premiership and also 93 as well.
Who was the toughest player that you had, Jobe, in your era that looked after you on the field?
I played younger with, Spike and Solly, and I remember, one of my favourite football stories is Mark McVay's on top of Jonathan Brown, and they're wrestling on the ground. And, Spike was a fiery character, and Jonathan Brown said to him, "McVay, I'm going to eat you today." And Spike, quick as a flash, replied, "Are you going to use the same bowl that you used to cut your hair with, Brownie?" So anyone who knows Brownie in the early days, he wasn't a lot of variety to the hairstyle that was going on, a very simple cut. Spike, it was a very good retort from Spike at the bottom of a pack, so I enjoyed spending time with him on the ground.
Very good. Now, before we get the final comments, we've got to play this. It's Your Call from Home, presented by Amart, and it does involve Jobe Watson, and the winner this week is Hamish Selberg.
And there's the boundary throw-in taken by Hill. Beautiful little hand pass to Watson. Watson busts through a tackle. Watson from the boundary line. Watson! How about that for a goal? Jobe Watson with an Anzac Day classic. Oh, Joby!
Bit of professionalism about that one.
Oh, it's almost a Coles voucher, I think, that one, if we can get in touch with it.
Maybe an Amart couch. Who knows?
Oh, I enjoyed that.
Yeah. Sorry, Xavier, I shouldn't probably put that pressure on you. Okay, it's time for the final comments. I guess there's a bit to get through, and it's a bit to probably reflect back on as well with some of the comments that John Worsfold made to us a little bit earlier on. Away you go, guys.
Oh, first, I just want to say a big shout-out to the Red Sash, who's in hospital. A lot of our listeners will know who the Red Sash is. I'd be a bit coded, but he's in hospital, so hopefully you get well, Sash. But, look, I thought John was terrific, guys. Just I would have liked to have had him more just talking about the structure of the hubs. And from a coaching perspective, the fact that, you know, for example, clubs are going to get 2 hours to train on the track, they're going to get 2 hours in the gym. Jobe, you are going to go mad with boredom, surely. I mean, if you're in these hubs and you're in there all day, the one thing that I used to struggle with as a player, we'd go the day before a game, that was fine, stayed overnight, play the game. But after that, it'd drive you mad, all your other teammates, after a while.
Yeah, when you think about the logistics and how it's actually going to work, it's going to be really challenging for all the players, all the staff, in these times. But I think that the pertinent thing to remember is it is challenging for everyone in society, and sure, I think we all have to be really flexible with how we're operating it. Understand that there is a new normal now, you know, and this, it may not last for a long period of time, but we are going to have to be flexible, and you are going to have to adapt. And I think it's the case for everyone. I would have really struggled with it, and I really would have found it difficult. But if it meant playing or not playing, then I think I would have said, okay, well, I'm just going to have to suck it up, because that's what's happening for everyone in society. And if it means that I can play, then I'll take my, you know, like I'll have to put up with it.
It's interesting, Joe, because I wish that you had had that philosophy when I was coaching and training went 10 minutes longer than you hoped it went, or that a meeting went 15 minutes longer than you went, because you were so flexible around staying an extra half an hour for an extra session back in the day. So
I wonder who I learned all that from, Birdie.
So to any current player out there who's played with Joe Watson, take his advice, not his actions, put it that way.
Yeah. No, I don't deny that it's going to be really tough, and I think it is. I think it's going to be really, really tough, and all these things that they're going to have to adapt to. But you know, you sort of look at it from a balance. Does it mean that we produce a product, and we're back in our jobs, or does it mean that and I have to put up with this, or do we not? And I think that everyone's faced with these circumstances in society. There is not like the status quo doesn't exist for anyone anymore, and we all are going to have to be flexible to prosper and to get through it.
We're at a point as well where clearly, you know, these two parties, the AFL and the AFLP, are now in discussions, and they're going to work through it, and they are going to get to a point where the players have an appropriate platform to raise their concerns. For the AFL to truly understand the perspective of the players and vice versa. And that's clearly, we're right at the start of that process, and we've still got 10 days before we need to get to a point where, you know, we're going to take greater advice from the experts, we'll get greater support, get greater clarity. So I feel really confident that the league and the AFLPA will be able to reach a position that appropriately caters for all. I genuinely feel like that. And just in the same way that the two parties have worked through, you know, whether we play round one, when we suspend, you know, suspended the season, and now the return to play piece. So it's nuanced, it's difficult, it's, nothing is ever perfect in times like this. And Jobe, I think your point about the broader society, I mean, geez, people are finding really complex and difficult. Like, you know, you've got a feel for those people, and we are going through the same challenges here, but I reckon by and large we're in a pretty good position.
I think so, Xavier. I just want to make a special shout out to a couple of special Essendon members, Maureen and Graham Sudwick. They were nominated as being fantastic community people in the Pakenham area, and Maureen recently had open heart surgery, and she's recovering well. And I just wanted to say thank you for all of your support and loyalty to the football club, and we hope you make a speedy recovery, Maureen. So thank you for listening, and hopefully you're back out in good health soon.
All right, so is that pretty much it? Any more final comments, or we're pretty much done?
No, I'd just say, Whitey, I think download the app. You know, stick to our social distancing. I think society's done such a great job, and we know that we want to get back to as close to normal as we can get to. And that discipline that we've shown, I genuinely feel proud of. When I look at our statistics versus the rest of the world and see what we're doing, like we've done such a great job. And to the government officials, to everyone in the way they're managing, like it's been brilliant. But let's not take the foot off the pedal. Let's keep going, because it will present some really good opportunities for us to rebound quickly as a society, which is important.
All right. And just finally, from this end, as I said, there's been so many text messages that have come through. Trisha has texted in, and she wanted to shout out to a friend, an Essendon member who's doing it tough, Kath Gibbons. So a shout out to Kath. I hope things are going well. We might try and maybe even chase that up, Xavier, throughout the course of the week as well, ahead of next week's program. And again, also with that call, if you want to get on your call from home, thanks to Amart, Darcy Parrish, and his goal back in 2016 is the latest one. So get involved in that as well. Thanks, guys. A day-night affair. We started in the daylight. Now we look outside, it's almost dark. We'll do it all again next week.
Thanks, Whitey. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys.
James Hurd, Joe Watson, and also Xavier Campbell. That's it from us. So we hope you've enjoyed the program. Thanks for all your interactions with John Worsfold on the line. And as I said, we'll do it all again next week. Enjoy the rest of your week.